Oh, hey, everybody, and welcome to this Wix Community Roundtable. I'm your host, Brett Harrelson, and today our topic is Wix accessibility. To talk about that, we're joined by Rotem and Nir. Welcome, guys.
Hi.
So before we jump into this, Rotem, Nir, tell us what you do at Wix and how long have you been working on accessibility specifically at Wix?
So I'm a product manager, senior product manager. I write from the editor. Over the last 3 years, I worked on accessibility. I also worked on some other great things in the editor. And now these days, I'm full-time dedicated to accessibility as part of the new accessibility team recently formed in Wix.
Hey, and I'm Rotem. I'm a product marketing manager, also in the accessibility team for around 2 years. I was also the marketing manager of the Wix blog and forum and most of the community products. And today I'm 100% devoted to accessibility and leading the marketing efforts for all of our accessibility products.
Accessibility is a huge umbrella, and there's a lot there. So I think one of the best things about this roundtable here is for us to kind of get into the nitty gritty about what is accessibility. So Rotem, I know you've got some stuff prepared, so I'm going to turn this over to you now.
Okay, thank you, Brett. So actually, we wanted to kickstart this roundtable with a great example of how thinking differently leads to innovation. So I guess we all know Rihanna. A few years ago, Rihanna decided to enter the beauty and makeup industry. And really soon she discovered that the common in the industry was to have around 3-4 shades, mostly for the white or let's say for the white skin. And she decided to kind of not take it as what it is, but she changed this conception and she decided to have lots of more shades because we have we have a huge variety of shades. And what she did, she created a few lines of colors, in each color, a lot of shades, something that fits everyone, all of the people. It led to a new industry, industry standard. So that's the industry standard today. So when you see when someone breaks this concept, breaks something that everyone thinks that's the way things should be, it leads to an amazing innovation and something that everyone can enjoy. And we have more examples, right?
One of the interesting things about that story was that the reason there was so little colors of makeup was because the people who designed the makeup were usually white people. And they looked around, they saw white people, it worked on them, so they felt happy. And this is the key motive that we are talking about here, and we are going to tell you another story. And this is about female astronauts currently in the International Space Station that was supposed to go to a spacewalk. And for that, they needed the special spacesuit. When they, after a lot of planning, they wanted to go out, they found out that the spacesuit doesn't fit them. And that's because the spacesuit was designed by men for the astronauts that were around them. And these astronauts were bigger, and therefore it didn't actually fit the female astronauts that needed to go out for the spacewalk. Since then, the relevant suit did was brought to the International Space Station. But then again, it was a story about when men designed the spacesuit for men astronauts and didn't think about everyone that should be the user of this spacesuit. It really only fitted the people that were around. And these examples sometimes can become more than annoying, but more even dangerous. But for example, if you're looking at the handrail in the train or bus, a lot of time the height of the handrail is the height of the ceiling minus the average height of the hand of again a female, sorry, of a man. And the reason is because most of the engineers who the buses were men, so it worked for them, and they assumed that it works for everyone. And if we look about on airbags in cars, then they were designed, invented in Sweden by Volvo. And again, the Swedish engineers are people, and they designed airbags that protected people like them. But when short people, shorter people were in the cars, they were actually hurting shorter people, because they were never took in account people that are not that size. The engineers didn't think about people that are not as big as them, let's say. And by the way, if women were to design cars, maybe it would look like the other image here, where it wouldn't fit men. We don't know. The key point here is that when we design product for people like us, for websites, okay, for people like us, we leave some people outside. We don't think inclusive. If we don't think about everyone, some people are left out, and it's not a nice sight to see. And when we talk about websites, okay, what are people like us? People like us are people who are sighted mouse users. So I'm guessing when a lot of you build a site, you do test your site and you give some other people to test it and see if it works for them, if it looks nice. But in many cases, you and these people are people who are sighted mouse users. So basically, you check it with a mouse and it looks nice and everything works and you are happy. But the thing is that there are a lot of people
who are not taking into consideration.
Exactly. And people who are blind, for example, and people who cannot use mouse for some reasons. And for these people, your site is not accessible, meaning they cannot consume the content that you want to give them, or they cannot buy your products, or they cannot, you know, use your website in any way. There is a great example in a link that we will send you for this interview, in which you can see Leonie Watson. She is a blind, very talented front-end developer, and she shows in an interview with Bruce Lawson how she tried to use a lot of websites that were not accessible, and how frustrating the experience is for her, and how it is completely unusable. It's not that it's annoying. She just cannot use this website. So we are not going to show you this video now, but I highly recommend, when you have some time to enrich your knowledge, check out this video. It will show you exactly what we're talking about.
I'll add it to the comments at the end.
So by now you might say, okay, I understand, blind people cannot use my website, but come on, how many blind people are there? I didn't see any blind person last week, and I don't know any blind person. And so let's talk a little bit about numbers, okay? First of all, we are not only talking about blind people. There are different kinds of disabilities, and even in each one of these categories, like we are talking about visual impairment and hearing and motor and cognitive, in each one of these categories, there is a variety of different types of disabilities. So it's not necessarily that someone is completely blind, but you know, my parents, when they watch Netflix, they need to turn on the subtitles, otherwise the captions, otherwise they cannot, they don't hear good enough. They are not deaf, but they just don't hear good enough, so they cannot use Netflix without it. So it's visual, it's hearing. Some people have some motoric disabilities, like the person on the left image cannot use his hand, so he uses a stick in his mouth to operate everything just with the keyboard. So if anything doesn't work with the keyboard, he cannot use it. You know, if you assume someone would just point the mouse, and great things will happen, he cannot use it. And Stephen Hawking, who could only live a couple of months, he needed very special assistive technology to compensate for all of his disability. But when he got it, he could do everything. He could change the world of physics and give academic lectures and do research and everything. There are people with cognitive disabilities, like epilepsy, that cannot experience flickering, or seasick or motion sickness, that have problem with things moving in different speeds. Or people with dyslexia who experience reading, like you might see now on this example, like everything feels like it moves for them, and they need a few more seconds to read the sentence that for you, or maybe ADHD, by the way, or ADD, the same, they will need some more time to read the same content than other people. So if you, for example, had a slideshow with three words in every slide, and you imagine that the person who see it and it autoplays, yeah, it moves every few seconds, and the person who see it will build the sentence in their mind, you need to understand that there are a lot of people who are not going to build the sentence. They're just going to be confused from all the bombardment of content that you throw at them at your pace and not at their pace. And if we calculate, you know, all the different types of disabilities, the estimations in the world, and most studies are around 17% of the populations are people who need some assistance in order to browse the web. 17% is 1 out of 6. Okay, we are talking about, like, if we only think about people with visual disabilities in the US alone that use the web, there are more than all the people who use the web in Mexico. And people with the hearing issues, disabilities that need some assistance in the US alone that use the web, are more than all the web users in Canada. So, like, it's like if you don't do what you need to do in order for them to come to your website, it's like you giving up Canada or giving up Mexico. It's a lot of business. And it's not only these people. We have disabilities which are temporary because I broke my arm, and just for the next couple of months, I cannot use a mouse, okay? Or temporary because I have cataract surgery and I'm just cannot see so good for a few weeks, I don't know. It can be temporary because of the situation, okay? I'm in a quiet library, so I cannot watch this video with volume, with audio. Or I'm in a noisy bar, so I can use it with audio, but I don't hear anything out of this video, and captions will help me. Or I'm walking in the sun with my phone, and if the color contrast is not good enough, I cannot read what's going on in the website. And not only that, if we calculate that, taking the fact that older people live longer these years, and this segment of population is becoming bigger, and by the way, this segment of population is a segment with a lot of free time, usually a lot of money, and they prefer a lot of time not going out from home but purchasing the web, because, you know, they have other issues that their body is sometimes prefers to stay at home. And these are exactly the people who want to come to your website and buy your products and book in your booking and in your events and whatever, you read your blogs. And these people, if we take them in account, estimations are that it's going to get to somewhere around 25 to 30%, 1 out of 5, 1 out of 4 people in the population that which cannot access the website if you didn't make it accessible. Huge number. Now, so what you understand now is that by making your site accessible, there are several advantages that you gain. The first one is that because of all these people, there are rules and requirements that you will make your site accessible to support and help them. And if you don't make yourself accessible, you might be exposed to a legal suit. And if you make it accessible, you reduce the risk of being sued. Of course, these numbers, these huge numbers of 1 out of 5, 1 out of 4 people, you want them in your site. You know, it's like a free potential. It's a very easy way to increase the potential traffic to your website, right? A lot of people are chasing millennials, which is a smaller segment in the population, and people are putting a lot of money to try and get them here. By making the effort of making your site accessible, you open the doors. It's like building a little ramp for wheelchairs inside, in the entrance to your store, and now all the people with the wheelchair will come to you because maybe the other stores doesn't have this ramp, right? And they are just looking for stores with ramps or websites which are accessible.
And for these people, they really like it's the easiest way to gain loyalty for your brand or affection for your brand, because once they need it and find it.
Yeah, this is the place to come back. You know, they are welcome at your website. And the last thing is, you know, it's just the right thing to do. And we started with it. The same way we don't want to create a business which is not accessible for women or not accessible for people of color or not accessible for, I don't know, any other reason. We don't want to create a business or website that is not accessible for people just because they have some disability. It's not something, it's not the world we want to live in. And so now that we understand what is accessibility and why is it important and why you should make your site accessible, it's time to go maybe to some of your questions.
So this is interesting. So we've had a lot of questions from the community over the past few months, and Rotem Nir and I have sort of scraped a lot of the conversations from within the community, and we've compiled what we think are the top few questions that we see a lot. And this is really, really interesting, because we've basically taken conversations, gone to the drawing board, and now we want to present those questions back to the community with answers. Of course, I'm not going to answer. This is all Rotem and Nir. So this is great, though, and I want to thank you guys for taking the time for this. This is fantastic.
I believe it.
Awesome. So let's kick off with the first. We took questions out of the group and we aggregated them into topics. Okay, mm-hmm. So we'll try to answer things according to an order that kind of makes sense for us. But if you have other questions later, we can get to it. First of all, is like, what is the difference between accessibility and WCAG and ADA? You hear all these terms and it's very confusing. So accessibility is the whole domain or field of helping people with disabilities live their life and do whatever they want and can. And it refers to everything from the little ramp for wheelchair in a store, accessible toilets in I don't know, any gas station, and an accessible website. Everything that helps people with disabilities. And by the way, assistive technology and anything you can think about that helps people with disability with the problems or compensate with the disability and is the domain of accessibility. Now, WCAG is a specification that was created to define what does it mean to build an accessible website, okay? It's a very important thing to understand that the people with disabilities have a lot of different assistive technology and tools that help them on a daily basis. You don't need to create a screen reader. They have the screen reader. You don't need to create braille screen or anything like this. They have it. What your responsibility is to build a website that the assistive technology can read. It's just mostly build websites correctly. So the WCAG 2.0 and 2.1 specification is the definition of what is a website that assistive technology can read. By the way, because In order for assistive technology to be able to read your website, it needs to be machine readable, okay? And other machines are SEO robots and crawlers, right? So if they can read your site better for assistive technology, it also usually will improve SEO, and you will see that there are requirements that are overlapping between accessibility and SEO for that reason. So WCAG is the definition of how to create an accessible website. What is ADA now? ADA is the law in the US specifically that talks about business accessibility. If I remember correctly, it's a law from 1991, was defined before internet was what it is today. And therefore it doesn't talk specifically about the website accessibility. However, they do require that the business will be accessible. And recently, Domino's Pizza lost in the Supreme Court in a case where they claimed that the website is not part of the business. And this loss means that the website is part of the business. And it needs to be accessible due to ADA, okay, due to the fact that there is a requirement for the business to be accessible. Now, an important thing to say is that the laws are different in different regions, in different countries, in different states, and you need to check with your, I don't know, local legal advice of what are exactly the requirements that are you need to meet. But usually most of the laws are based on WCAG, on the international specification. So whenever we are working on accessibility, we're working according to WCAG, and it covers most legal things. But again, after you finish doing everything that we are going to explain with your website, you still need to make sure that in your region, in your local area, there are no additional requirements and specific things that you need to meet. We cannot guarantee compliancy because of that fact. We don't know what markets you are approaching and what exactly is the different laws in every area. And it's also changing sometimes. And so make sure to check it. Is ADA compliance a global requirement? So again, no. In Israel, there is a law that talks specifically about web accessibility from a few years ago, from 2016. In Canada, I think about a year ago, in the UK, I think in September, the laws came in. In the EU, there are also laws in Australia, I think, in Brazil. Like, you need, there are different laws in different countries with slightly different requirements. So again, make sure, and ADA is just one of them. It's just the American one. And so you need to make sure which ones are relevant for you and that you meet the requirements. Is the business owner responsible or the designer of the website responsible? So again, I will take it to the brick and mortar example. If you see a store, just a normal store that is not accessible and someone with a wheelchair cannot come into the store, he's going to sue probably the store owner, not the engineer, not the designer. The store owner in his turn might sue someone else, I don't know, but basically the responsibility is of the business, okay? When I ask for a designer or someone, one of my requirements should be I want it to be accessible as well, okay? So this is for this question. Now, the question is, how do we know if we meet all the requirements? So we've created for you a accessibility checklist, which we will also give you a link in the comments for. And this checklist is, I will even send something before. In Wix, we do everything that we can do for you, okay? Any requirement that we can do for you, we already did. If it comes to keyboard functionality, we added keyboard functionality to all of our components and products. If it comes to the order of things, we are usually, wherever we can, we order the document for you. If it comes to semantics and ARIA attributes, which makes the experience with screen reader better, we take care of it for you. However, when it comes to content, since it's your contents, the images, the colors, the heading structures, these are things that we cannot do for you because it's your content, and you cannot choose colors for you, and for example. So we do have instructions for you, some checklist that talks mostly about your content and what you need to check and make sure that is correct. When it comes to the content, this is the accessibility checklist. And when you build your website, you need to review these requirements. They are in mostly going to be, some of them going to be very familiar for you, again, from SEO. And you know, after one or two sites that you did it, that you reviewed the accessibility checklist, it's going to become part of how you think about building a website. You know, part of the brief, I will already think about the structure of the heading, the color palette that you pick will already be accessible because you know the requirements. And so everything you need to know is written in these requirements. That being said, again, I remind you, the last requirement is make sure with your local accessibility advisors and what is exactly the specific requirements of the laws in your area. We assume that we are covering everything because we are based on WakeUp, but if there are additional requirements of things that you see that our system don't support, don't know how to do, of course, you can contact us and we'll make sure and we'll have it. Okay. Now, is Wix considering developing an accessibility tool such as the SEO Wiz? The answer is yes. In order to make the whole process of the checklist that I've just mentioned much easier, straightforward, and clear, we are working on a tool that will guide you, lead you, and help you quick fix everything. However, it is taking some time because it's not a small thing. We will promise you that you are going to hear about it first and probably test it first as soon as we can share it with you. Until then, do the checklist. Does this only affect agencies or big businesses? Again, it depends on the law. And you need to check it. In Israel, there is an exemption for businesses who have revenue smaller than, I don't remember how much, like $200,000 a year, I don't remember, but you need to check what is the requirements in your country, in your regions, and it changes. In some countries, we know that every site needs to be accessible, no exemption, okay? So check it. Can I add alt text to images, including background images?
So okay, now, just to make it there, we're now like moving from the big picture of what really is accessibility and most of it, like a lot of questions that you asked in order to really understand the accessibility field. So now we're moving to more to questions that we gathered mostly about how to do things or can you do some things inside the editor, inside your websites.
And I can add to it that we are, well, in addition to everything technical that we are talking about, products and tools, we are also working hard, on providing you more information in more accessible ways about accessibility, about what is accessibility, what our features are, how to use them, what you need to do for experts, so for novice, for everything. So we already have a lot of support articles about it, but it's going to be
sooner we'll have a home for it.
Much nicer, much friendlier, and it's coming soon as well as part of our efforts to help you with accessibility. So let's continue. Can I add alt text to images, including background images? So yes and no. We have added the ability to add alt text to SVGs and other things. As for background images, not yet, but again, we're working on it. I cannot give a commitment as an estimation, but it's in the works. It's a little, there are some things that takes more effort and less effort, and that's why in normal images it was available earlier, but again, we are working on it and it's coming. What is considered a caption? A text below an image, or the text that appears when you hover on the image, and so on. So first of all, because there is a mix of captions and images, okay? Usually captions is what you see in a video that gives the information of what the people are talking on, in the text that people are, of the conversation that are happening in the video. As for text, there can be a title above the image that tells what this image is about. The preferred way is to use the alt text or alternative text feature in the image settings, which have three uses, okay? The first one is for accessibility, of course. People who cannot see the image hear what is in the image because you describe it to them. The second one is for SEO. Again, in the SEO, robots cannot see your image, but they can read the alternative text, so you do give them more information than what they have without it. And the third use, which is actually the first one, is if the image doesn't load from some technical reasons, people can see what the alternative is, like what is in the image. It's more related to slow networks, to the early days of the internet, but still useful. So use alt text. The reason alt text is better than a title next to the image is because if it's next to the image, there is no semantic connection between them. It's just a box. They are one next to the other. Maybe they are related, maybe they are not. When it is the alt text, alternative text of the image, there is a clear connection between them. This is the text of this image.
Yeah, I think I put the example of a caption that is not, is like if you have an image that someone took the photo, you can write above or below the image who took the photo or
yeah.
something like that, and then it gives the whole story. But alt text is really what connects the image to what the machine understands. So.
Exactly. In the future, we are working on some more tool that we might help you create this. A semantic connection, but at this point it's not yet available. But if you want to create a semantic connection between two things, put them in a container, put them in the same box. This tells everyone that they are related. Let's continue. Can I use lightbox that are triggered automatically? So basically, it's possible. It very much depends on the scenario and the situation. It depends what is in the light box and stuff like this. I do recommend reviewing the requirements of WCAG, which we'll also link to, for your specific case, to make sure if in this case or not it is required. And that's it. That's what we can say about this. Animations, are they considered violation? So as we mentioned earlier, people with motion sickness and other cognitive disabilities might experience animation as a problem. Sometimes animations are used for decoration. In some cases, animations are very annoying, like if there's too much use of animation. But sometimes animation try to convey some information, okay? They tell me a story. And when you use animations in this way, first of all, like use animations as when it's needed. It's a good practice in general, not only for accessibility. We are going to add a new feature which will allow visitors to your website to stop all animation and motion. It's currently in testing. So if they did require it from their operating system and you did put animation, it's going to stop it for them. However, a lot of people with disabilities are not aware of this feature. So again, use animation when it's needed, when it's helpful. By the way, if they are conveying something and giving some clues to the people who use the site, you need to remember that it's a visual clue, and you need to give some hint for people who don't see your site. And this is kind of like, well, animation is becoming a problem. You need somehow to give the same clue for people who didn't see the animation. So take it in account. Third-party apps and widgets. Okay, so we 2 years ago, we did open the option to add toolbars and third-party applications to your websites, and it's nice. However, these widgets and applications and toolbars does not replace the need to make to build your site correctly. Okay, they does not replace going over the checklist and make sure everything you did is done correctly. There, because there are some things that these toolbars cannot fix. And in addition, you need to understand that most of the features in these toolbars, high contrast, text size, and stuff like this, are available in the operating system level. And most people with disabilities will use their own accessibility tools because they want consistency. They want the same tool no matter what site they are going to, and they don't want in every site to start and understand how they increase the contrast in this website. So I think what we can say about it is, first of all, do the checklist. Then if you want to add a third party toolbar or application or widget of accessibility to your website, you can do it. Don't think that if you did it, you don't need to do anything on your website. It doesn't make your website accessible by magic. There is, unfortunately, no technology like this.
Let the machines read your website correctly. Like, it doesn't go there.
Exactly.
Mostly the UI and the, I guess.
Yes. Last but not least, are Wix products compliant? And people ask about restaurants and booking and events and such and stores and blog. So the answer is yes. We are working on all of our products and editor components and everything you can use. And we have, again, a team of accessibility experts in Wix that are helping to define accessibility requirements for every new feature we release. They are testing them before they are released. We are working with external organization of people with disabilities that also review our products. And basically, we keep improving the accessibility level of all of our products. That being said, this is the software world. Bugs do happen, and sometimes things that were okay are breaking. So if you do find accessibility issues with our products, let us know, and we'll, of course, work on it. But you can assume when you build a website that that all of our products are accessible, and we are working very, very hard across all the company to make sure that you don't need to worry about it. I think this was the last question.
Yeah, just another addition to that question. We left the question, do blog posts have to be ADA compliant? So let's divide it to two. First of all, I think we closed in the beginning, what is ADA, what is WCAG, what is accessibility? So we're not talking in the ADA jargon, but more about like, are they accessible or not? And near answer that yes, most of our products are already accessible, if not all. And the question about blog posts, so yeah, of course they have to be accessible. All of your websites, all of your pages in your website needs to be accessible. Same as if we go back to a store, to an actual store, example, if your store is accessible, then it's accessible by everything. It has accessible toilets, it will have accessible fitting rooms, and everything would be accessible, not some of it would be. So same thing goes here. All of your blog posts, all of your bookings, all of your all of your pages need to be accessible and not have some yes and some no. I think that's the closure of it.
So I think this was incredibly informative, and there's a lot of information here to unpack and digest. So those are some really good questions from the community, and I think you guys did a really good job of explaining what ADA is, what accessibility is, what it means to be compliant, how to be compliant in your region. And of course, we're not the authority of that, and Wix can't tell you that. You have to go, like you said, Nir, you need to go find what your region requirements are. So I think for an intro to accessibility, this is everything I think in a nutshell somebody would need to know at first glance.
Right.
Yes. And now it's your time, your job, your turn. You know, go make the web accessible for everyone. It's just, let's make a better world.
Yeah.
I like it. I like it a lot. So I want to thank both of you again for coming and explaining what accessibility is in ADA. And this has been amazing and super informative. So I'll let everybody go digest this and unpack. So thanks, guys. Thanks, everybody.
Thank you.